Hello, and welcome to this presentation. My name is Joakim Jaldén, and I'm a professor of signal processing at the Royal Institute of Technology. So this presentation will be a popular scientific presentation of some research that we did in a project funded by Mabtech, who approached us to solve the problem of spot counting in RAWspot and LRSpot. And I'll present the model-based spot counting algorithm that we developed. So the problem of counting spots is relatively easy if the spots are well separated and homogeneous, so similar in size and intensity. However, that's not the case typically in RAWspot and LRSpot assays, where the spots typically vary in size and intensity, and also frequently falls together and cluster. So in order to understand why the problem of counting these spots is difficult using an automated method, let's consider an example of a commonly used spot counting method. So in this case, the curve shows a cross-section of the luminosity of the spots going through these four spots in the center there. So you'll have spot 1 and 2, which gives distinct peaks. The spot 4, which is dimmer, will also give a distinct peak, but spot 3 will be partially occluded by the second spot. So a very common way to count spot is to simply threshold the image. So we apply a thresholding level, and everything above this level is counted as a spot. But now we see the problem with such an approach in this case is that the three spots which are merged together will be jointly segmented as a single spot, not showing the three individual spots that we have in the data. Of course, we can separate this cluster by raising the level of the threshold, thereby separating spots 1 and 2. However, if we raise the level needed in order to separate those spots, we totally lose the weak spots. So this is not an acceptable solution. And we also don't recover spot number 3, which is close to the main spot and occluded. Another very common method of counting spots is simply to go for local maxima in the intensity curve. And that would give us, in this case, three spots along the line and the two spots off center. This is clearly a better result or better solution in this particular case. However, it still fails to recover spot number 3, which has been masked by the stronger spot next to it. And such an approach would be very susceptible to noise. So if you have noise in the signal, which you always will have, you need to first filter the signal in order to remove the spurious peaks before finding the local maxima. And this will further smooth the data, causing you to merge spots which were separated before the smoothing. So the challenges, to recap, is that spots vary in size, shape, and intensity. The image noise would adversely affect performance of weaker spot counting methods. And the strong spots may partially occlude weak spots or mask them, causing a cluster of unidentified spots. So the method that we propose to use instead is a model-based source point localization algorithm. And this method uses a realistic physical observation model and formulates what's called an inverse problem. I'll come back to that. And then it applies numerical large-scale optimization in order to find the sources of the spots, thereby localizing the cells that created the spots. So in order to understand the basis of this, we need to look into the physics of spot formation. So in a typical assays, you'll have cells at the bottom of a well on a membrane producing particles. And once the cell releases a particle, it'll diffuse in the liquid above the surface, move around, possibly be captured by antibodies on the surface if it comes in contact with the surface. It may be re-released and then again captured. So the path of a single particle is random due to the Brownian motion that it'll experience in the liquid above it. But a cell won't just release a single particle, it'll release many of them. And these particles will diffuse in the liquid. Some of them will get stuck to the membrane, creating a characteristic pattern. And then at some point, the free particle is washed away, detection antibodies are added, and the assay is imaged, creating a luminosity profile around each cell. So to recap, at the microscopic level, individual particles behave randomly and they exhibit Brownian motion, are stochastically captured and released at the bottom of the well. At a macroscopic level, the whole family of particles behave predictably, or at least the density of particles behave predictively according to different equations that describe the diffusion and absorption and desorption processes at the bottom of the well. So this allows for a physical model which takes as input a description of where and when individual particles are released into the medium, and then predicts statistically where those particles will be captured. And that physical model can be used in order to invert the process and figure out where the particles came from. So this brings us to what's called an inverse problem. An inverse problem we can solve by optimization in order to figure out from where the particles originated. So in the language of inverse problems, the forward problem is precisely this physical model. So it's taking the spatial-temporal particle release map and producing an estimate of where the particles would be found bound to the bottom of the well. The inverse problem is just what it sounds like, the inverse of that problem. So given the density of bound particles, the thing we can directly observe with the camera, to deduce this spatial-temporal particle release map. So in order to understand the algorithm which solves the inverse problem, let's consider an example. So at the beginning of the algorithm, or beginning of the iterations, we don't know from where the particles originated. So let's make a hypothesis that particles were generated uniformly across the bottom of the well. That will, through the physical model, also predict that particles will be captured uniformly across the well. However, that of course doesn't compare well with the measurements that were actually made. But now when we have this comparison, we can see that there are certain parts of the measurements where no particles are captured. And it's not very likely that they were produced close to this location in that case. So we could use that as an update and remove particles in the hypothesis that are from areas where there is no captured particles in the measurement. And that brings us to something which is very close to the actual measurement, or an hypothesis which is very similar to the measurement. But then we know that if this was truly the particle release locations, or the centers of the spots, then by the model, because we have the diffusion, some particles will diffuse away from the cells. The prediction says that we would have a much more fuzzy image, or a less clear image, than what we actually measured. But now comparing this new prediction with the measurement, we can refine the hypothesis, slowly localizing the spots in an iterative fashion. And if you continue doing this for long enough, you can very precisely locate the spot centers, or build a hypothesis which only relies on a few spot centers and gives a prediction which is very close to the measurement. And this is an indication that we are very close to the true hypothesis of where particles were produced originally on the bottom of the well. So the hypothesis matches reality and we've solved the inverse problem. But this visualization only captures part of what the algorithm can describe. So for instance, it explains the spot centers, but it doesn't explain why this particular spot on the edge here, spot number 4, would produce a very large and faint spot, while spot number 3 on the cross section would produce a very narrow spot. And the reason why these produce different spots is that the particles released from these locations would release at different times. So particles released early on in the experiments will have more time to diffuse and to bind further away from the cell than particles which are released later in the experiment. So in order to capture that, we have to look at the temporal dimension as well. So let's look again at the cross-section that we looked at before and add this temporal dimension. So redoing the algorithm that we did before, what it would correspond to would be having several different explanations of particles released for different positions in the well at different times. And by slowly updating that, relating that prediction to what is actually measurement. So in this case, the prediction is shown in green and the measurement is shown in blue. We can iteratively refine those hypotheses through the prediction in order to get a closer match. And at the end of the day, we'll be able to locate not only in space, but also in time where particles have released, fully explaining the data. And from here on, it's of course a trivial task to identify where the spots are in the spatiotemporal model. And it allows us to then break those clusters which were troubling for simpler methods. Okay, so to recap, the benefit of the source point localization algorithm that we developed in this project and which is now implemented in Mabtech's IRIS reader is improved spot accuracy. It is also capable of resolving clusters of spots relying on the physical model and solving the inverse problem. And because we don't only explain from where the particles originate, but also when, we're able to tell different spots apart by their properties. So the algorithm becomes able to accurately assess spot properties, such as size or intensity, or even the volume corresponding to the number of particles released by the spot overall. So this has been a popular scientific presentation of the algorithm that we developed, and the images in this presentation are chosen in order to illustrate the core principles of the algorithm. If you're interested in a more scientific evaluation of the qualities of the algorithm, or the full derivation of the physical model that is used in the inverse problem, or how we can guarantee that the update rules indeed converge to a valid solution to the problem. You can look at the scientific publications, which are published as the two-part papers in the IEEE Transactions of Signal Processing.